All right, everybody, if you want to find a seat, if you're still coming in. And we will get going on our lecture today, because we have various things to cover. It's a bit broken up today into various different things. Thank you. So we're going to cover wind systems. So we're going to look at some of the local different wind systems that we see, things like the monsoons, things like our land sea breezes, things like the Santa Ana winds, which is very appropriate today. We're also then going to start thinking about air masses and fronts. And if anyone has ever seen a weather forecast, which hopefully at least you've done one time in your life, you'll have heard things like, oh, there's a cold front moving in or a warm front moving in, and that affects our weather. So at the very end today, we're going to have a go at forecasting our weather for the next sort of 5-6 days, and we're going to see when our Santa Ana winds are going to come to an end, and we can go back to actually being able to sleep at night and things like that. So, midterms. We have all of the midterms. The TAs are going to be outside lecture hall after class today, so please do take the opportunity to get your midterm back and take a look at it. I know it's a painful thing to do at times, but it is helpful because you can work out where you went wrong. So was it a timing thing? And I am aware, I've had various conversations with people that people found this a really long exam. It was the same length as last year's, but for some reason it took a bit longer to complete this time round. So I will take that into account when I set the final. There will be a little bit more time for you in the final, so don't panic about that. But was it that you didn't understand a concept, or was it that you made a silly mistake, or did you not include the units, or something like that? If it's a concept thing, then now is the time to approach your TA or me in office hours or in the review sessions. Remember, I hold review sessions today on Tuesdays and Wednesdays from 4 till 5. On Tuesdays, it's in Crowell Hall, 3101, and on Tuesdays, it's in PCB 1200. Okay, and I'll send out a reminder email about that if I need to. Okay, so do take the opportunity to get your midterm back. So what are we going to do today? We are going to focus on wind systems for the first bit. We're going to do a little review of what we did on Thursday, because Thursday was a pretty challenging class in terms of some of the concepts. So we'll do a little review of that, and at the same time, we'll go through some of the quiz questions that people found a little bit challenging this time around. Then we'll go into thinking about these wind systems. Then we're going to talk about air masses and fronts. And really, that last part of today, we're going to be looking at pulling together a whole bunch of the different stuff we've learned about. Pressure, winds, low and highs, and what that means about whether we're going to have air rising or falling, and what that means in terms of humidity, as well as things like cloudiness that happens along fronts. So, online quiz, a little bit more challenging this week because it's slightly more challenging information. So, first of all, we have upwelling and downwelling. And I think most people are really quite happy with the concept that if we have surface water moving away from the coastline, we're going to have to pull deeper water up to replace that surface water that's moving away. And if we're at the coastline and surface water is moving towards the coastline, it can't just pile up against the coast. It can't go up and over the mountains. It's going to end up sinking back down. It's going to downwell if that water moves towards the coast. But where we had a bit of trouble was this one. So in this one, I've basically done the reverse of what I told you last time. Last time I gave you the wind direction, and I asked you to work out for me what the surface water was doing. This time, I've given you what the surface water is doing, and I want you to tell me what wind direction causes that to happen. Okay? So, what hemisphere are we in? The southern. So what is my surface water going to do? Is it going to move to the left of the wind or the right of the wind? The left. So which way is my wind going to be moving? South to north, okay? So if you look at my diagram here, if my surface water is going in this direction, and that's 90 degrees to the left of my wind, then my wind has to be going from south to north in order for that water to be going left. If it was going from north to south, remember you always look along the direction of motion, that water would be moving onto the land. Does that make sense now, for those who didn't quite get it? Well, you're going to have a chance to prove it to me. So, work out which hemisphere we're in. So now I'm going to ask you the other way around again. Now I have the wind direction again. So tell me, which way is that water going to move? And is that going to result in upwelling or downwelling? Okay. So talk to your neighbor for a minute or two. See if you can work it out. 3/4 split. I'll take it. That'll do. Which hemisphere are we in? The southern. So is my water going to go to the left or the right of my wind? To the left. It's going to go at 90 degrees to the left. So is that towards land or away from land? Towards land. And that water can't keep piling against the land. It's going to be forced down. We're going to have downwelling going on there. So are we going to have lots of life or relatively little life in that location? Relatively little life, because all of those nutrients, remember, in that deep water, and we need to bring that deep water to the surface in order to make those nutrients accessible for things to use them in photosynthesis. So I think most people have got that. If you don't, I'm very happy to go through it in the review session or my office hours. So the second thing that we talked about in terms of ocean-atmosphere interaction was our gyres. We talked about these because we have those different directions of winds around the equator. We have our easterly trade winds, and then further towards the poles, we have our westerlies. We have the winds going in other directions, and that's the way that we associate weather sort of moving in from the Pacific towards us, right? And what that does is that both of those wind directions force water into the very center of our ocean, into the center of the North Atlantic, the South Atlantic, the North Pacific, the South Pacific, and also our Indian Ocean. So we set up these 5 gyres because we have basically just like a high pressure system in the atmosphere, we have a high of sea level, and that water will try and move out of that high, and it will be deflected to the right in the Northern Hemisphere. And so in the Northern Hemisphere, that water ends up going, does it go clockwise or counterclockwise? It's even on there. Clockwise, thank you. And in the Southern Hemisphere, it ends up going counterclockwise because it's going out and to the left. Okay? So we have our 5 gyres. And so our next question that seemed to cause a little bit of trouble was, due to the movement of surface ocean water in the North Pacific, which coastline would have warmer and more humid climates? So if we're looking for warmer and more humid climates, are we looking for warmer water off the coast or colder water? Warmer. So we're looking for areas where water is moving from the equator towards the pole. And on which side of the North Pacific does that happen? On the western side, right? The west side of the Pacific, which is the east coast of Asia. Because we know here, usually our climate is pretty nice and relatively cool, right? Because we have that nice cold ocean water that comes past and keeps us cool. Whereas that's not necessarily true of the western Pacific, okay? And where people went wrong, I think, was they were pretty good at getting the western Pacific, but Australia is not in the northern hemisphere. It's not part of that North Pacific Gyre. It's part of the South Pacific Gyre, but that's not quite the same thing. So I think that was the problem there rather than anything else. So then we talked about deep ocean circulation, which isn't wind-driven as such, but it has a really important control on our climate. And we saw that because we can look back in time and at certain times in the past when we had a huge amount of extra ice around our northern hemisphere pole, then we've seen situations where it will switch itself off and we see very dramatic swings in temperature. This is our day after tomorrow scenario, which is a lot of fun. And you can see that those purple areas represent areas where surface water becomes so dense, really, really cold and really salty, becomes so dense that it sinks right from the surface down to 4 kilometers depth. Okay? And then it will start circulating through the very, very bottom of our oceans, all the way down through the Atlantic, spreads out through the Southern Ocean, and then also up into the North Pacific, where it finally comes back up to the surface. So So when that water comes back up to the surface near us, it's really old. It hasn't really been in contact with the atmosphere for maybe 1,000 years or longer. So that water has been down there a really long time. Because this process takes a long time for that water to flow around. But it transports a huge amount of energy. If you imagine just how much water there is in those oceans, and it's in that sort of very slow, constant motion. It also, we didn't talk about this, but it also stores a huge amount of carbon. If we look at where we're locking carbon into the ocean, it's basically where those purple circles are, because that's where that extra atmospheric carbon dioxide that we've been putting up there starts dissolving in that water, and then that water sinks right to the bottom of the oceans. And so our concern is not that it's going to shut down. We don't have enough fresh water that it's just going to shut down. But it certainly looks like it's slowing down. And that's going to change a little bit of the energy transfer between the equator and the poles, in the North Atlantic especially. And it's also going to start changing things like how much carbon we can put into the deep ocean and lock away out of the atmosphere, to sort of save us some time in terms of how much our climate is warming. So it's a pretty important thing, even if it's not driven by our atmosphere, it has an important control on our climate system. If anyone has any questions, by the way, feel free to stop me as we go. So lastly, we talked about El Niño and ENSO, which is an interesting thing right now because we're looking at moving for the first time in quite a while into an El Niño type phase. Now we're talking about 60 to 80%. It's something that you're seeing in the news relatively often. And so ENSO is this quite complicated interaction between the oceans and atmosphere. And usually you can see my normal conditions in the central image there. We have these easterly trade winds. So they go from sort of the Americas across the Pacific towards Indonesia, Australia. And as those winds blow along the equator, they move that warm water. They basically blow that nice surface water that's been absorbing heat from the sun along in that direction. And so that piles up warm water in the Western Pacific, and in the Eastern Pacific, the movement of that water away from the coastline brings up deeper water, colder water, water that's full of nutrients up to the surface. And so in the Eastern Pacific, normally we have high productivity. We have lots of life, sort of lots of fisheries off Peru and those areas. And in the Western Pacific, it's much hotter. It also means that where we get that hotter seawater, we have more rainfall. We have more evaporation. We have more unstable air. We're more likely to get rain. But in El Niño years, such as what we think we're moving towards, we don't necessarily see those easterly trade winds. Someone asked me a very good question. They emailed and said, well, hang on, the Earth's still spinning the same way. Why do we see a weakening or even a reversal of these easterly trade winds? And the answer is we don't have a good idea yet. It's something that we would love to understand more about. And there's some sort of complicated physics, perhaps, but the fundamental idea is that we don't have a clear sense yet of why that is, and we'd love to know more. But what that means is that we don't blow water away from the Eastern Pacific, that coastline of South America, so we don't get upwelling. Those fisheries don't do well because we don't have those nutrients feeding our surface life. And also that changes the distribution of where that warm water is. So it also changes the distribution of where the rainfall occurs. So we get much drier conditions in Australia. They're very concerned. The agricultural sector there is already sort of thinking about what they're going to do to deal with potential drought due to an El Niño event, because they're already not in a good way. Whereas we on our side, as I said, it's pretty okay for us because we get more rain and we need that rain right now. And then La Niña conditions is basically the reverse. Okay, we get just more extreme of that normal conditions. So we get even more upwelling, even more productivity in the east, even more rainfall over Indonesia and Australia. Okay, so we're going to see what happens with that later this year, and hopefully you guys can keep an eye on it too. So, our three-cell conceptual model. Don't worry, I'm not going to draw it again, but I do want to make the point that we've talked now about things like are ITZZ, that intertropical convergence zone, where we have air coming together, air rising along the equator where it's warm, forming our band of clouds. And that band of clouds results in our tropical rainforests that we find at the equator. We have our trade winds, those easterly winds, and it also explains why we get westerlies and then easterlies once again up near the poles. We have our desert distribution, that sinking air at 30 degrees north and south and at the poles creates high pressure areas, and as air sinks, does it expand or compress? Compress. Does it warm up or cool down? Warms up. And so we move away from saturation, we have nice clear skies. Okay, so that explains why we have desert conditions and why it doesn't often rain down here in Southern California. And we said that this model is great, but it can't explain what's happening high up. Can't explain, for example, our polar jet streams. And that's because really the big control up high in the atmosphere is not those little cells, it's the fact that those different air columns are sort of different heights due to the different temperatures. And then lastly, I sort of threw it a throwaway point at the time. It doesn't take into account land-sea contrasts in heating and cooling. And so I've highlighted that in red because that's what we are going to spend the first part of today talking about. We're going to think about what wind systems result from these sort of differences that can't be explained with our three-cell model. And so first of all, something that we definitely enjoy, because you know that on a really hot day like this, when the Santa Anas usually aren't blowing, we have a lovely breeze in the afternoon, right? That air comes off the sea and it keeps us nice and cool. So let's think about why that happens. It's a sea breeze that we experience in our afternoons. So remembering back to specific heat, does the land or the ocean warm up more quickly? The land warms up more quickly. It has a smaller specific heat, takes less energy added to that land to increase the temperature of it. Okay? So if we imagine over the course of a day, maybe in the morning we start off with temperatures over the land and the ocean being about the same. But as that day progresses, that land is going to get hotter and hotter and hotter much more quickly than the ocean. Okay? And so the air above the land gets much hotter than above the ocean. And so what do we know about hot air? Does it stay where it is? It rises, okay? So we have this air rising away from the surface, or that land surface. And so what do we create there? Do we create a little high or a low above the land? We're taking air away. A low. Do you remember we said if you let air out of your tire a little bit, it's going to be lower pressure left behind. Whereas over the ocean, we don't necessarily have that air rising. It's still relatively cool. And so over the ocean, we have a relative high pressure. That air isn't rising as much. And which way does air go? From low to high or high to low? High to low. And so we have this air during the day. As that land gets warmer and warmer and air rises over the land, it pulls in cool air from over the ocean. And so if you're down at Newport Beach, you know that in the afternoon we have this lovely breeze coming off the ocean and it keeps us warmer. It's why it's pretty miserable in Riverside today. Well, still pretty miserable here as well. But later this week, it's going to be even more miserable in Riverside and it's going to be pretty nice here because we're going to start seeing those sea breezes again. Okay. So my question for you, what about at night? So which way would the wind blow at the surface at night? So have a think about it. See if you can work through the logical steps. Speak to your neighbor, and I'll give you a second to think about it. Okay, let's see if you can read my diagrams. 70% of people can read my diagrams. At night, which way is the wind blowing on my bottom diagram there? From the land to the ocean. So let's think about why that's true. So at night, which is going to cool down more quickly, the land or the ocean? The land is going to cool down more quickly as well. So where is the warmer air going to be, over land or the ocean? The ocean. And so now we have a relatively warm air over the ocean, which might rise a little bit. That creates a low over the ocean. We have nice cold stable air above the land. It's not going anywhere. It's really cold. And so we get movement from high to low again. And so now we see a reversal. And so next time you're down at Newport Beach at night, see if you can identify the land breeze. That direction of that wind changes. Okay? So that's our land sea breezes. And so later this week, when they sort of come back again, take note of it. Think about what's happening with the atmosphere. So, monsoons. I know that quite a few people are in the class are from areas where there are monsoons. And so what is a monsoon? It's a climate system that has just two seasons. So we have a hot, dry season and a season where we have very heavy precipitation. And our most famous example is that Asian monsoon system over India and China. So let's think about what causes that to form. And really, we're going to come back to the same sort of ideas that we had for our land-sea breezes. But instead of thinking it on a daily timescale, we're now going to think about it as a seasonal timescale instead. So, in winter, let's think about our gigantic continent of Asia. It's this huge, huge landmass. So what do you think the temperature is like in the middle of Asia in the middle of winter? Is it going to be lovely and warm or really horrible and cold? Terribly cold, absolutely. It would be terribly cold because, remember, it's got that sort of low specific heat. It can change temperature really well, okay? You don't want to be in the middle of Asia in the middle of winter. It's going to be cold. And so that air is going to be very cold as well. It's going to be stable. It's not going to want to rise. So we have a high pressure over the Asian continent in the middle of winter. Okay? Over the Indian Ocean, we're going to have relatively warm conditions still. Okay? That sea, that ocean is not responding as quickly to that change in energy. And so we're going to have warmer conditions. We're going to have relative low pressure over the Indian Ocean. That's even more true because we have our intertropical convergence zone, which, do you remember, shifts north and south with the seasons. And so it happens to be that in the winter season, that intertropical convergence zone, which is a low, is sat over our Indian Ocean. So the arrows show you which way is the wind going to go. It's going to go from high to low. It's going to go from the very center of that continent outwards. Okay, so how much moisture do you think is in the air in this very center of the Asian continent? What does logic tell you? Compared to the air over the ocean, how much moisture is there going to be in the air? Less. Very little, right? It's in the middle of a continent. It hasn't got access to water sources, so there's going to be relatively little moisture there to begin with. The air is also really cold. So it also doesn't contain much moisture. So let's now think, what happens to that air as it comes off the Asian continent? What does it sort of arrive at? What does it pass on its way to the ocean? It's labeled on there. The Himalayas, absolutely. It's going to pass the Himalayas, and it's going to come down the Himalayas, right? If it's going to come from Asia down and out across India to the ocean. So what happens to that air as it comes down the Himalayas? Does it compress or expand? Compress. Does it warm up or cool down? And so we're warming up this really already very dry air. So we're never ever going to get clouds and rainfall. Okay? So now let's think what happens in summer. Okay? So in summer, is it going to be really, really hot in the middle of Asia or really, really cold? Really, really hot. Again, it warms up very quickly. It has this low specific heat. And that means that it's going to be warmer than over the ocean. It's going to be a gigantic low pressure system because that air is going to be warm. It's going to be rising. We also shift that ITZZ, that low pressure convergence zone, slightly north as well onto that continent. So now we have air blowing from high over the Indian Ocean to a low inland. How much moisture is going to be in the air over the Indian Ocean? Lots or very little? Lots. There's going to be lots of moisture. And it blows onto land, and so we're going to get a certain amount of rainfall. But then what does it hit on its way inland? The Himalayas. And so as it rises, is it going to compress or expand? Is it going to warm or cool? Cool. And so we're going to have enormous amounts of clouds and rainfall. Okay? So we're just putting together those ideas that you've heard before in a different way, and all of a sudden we can explain this amazing, enormous monsoon system that we see. Okay? So it isn't just in Asia. We also see monsoon systems elsewhere. We see one over Australia, in East Africa, the South American monsoon, and we also even have somewhat of a monsoon system here. And in a lot of those places, we don't have the enormous mountain ranges, so it's not as an intense a monsoon system. But we also get this difference between high pressure and low pressure over the land compared to the ocean, and that reverses those winds and causes different weather in different seasons. Does that make sense so far? Hopefully? Okay. So, on to our favorites, the ones that we are experiencing today. I still quite enjoy the Santa Anas. So, we have different words, but they're basically just words from different parts of the world to describe exactly the same thing. So I'm just gonna stick with Santa Anas. It's easier to spell, and it's the ones that are local to us. But really, these are just identical ideas. They're all formed by this adiabatic compression and warming of air as it comes down from mountains. Just depends where in the world you are to what you call them. So, here in our part of the world, we know that we have Santa Ana winds when we have a big high-pressure system sat just inland from us, okay? Because air is gonna go from high to low. It's gonna come out of that high. And what direction does it get deflected in the northern hemisphere? To the right. So as it comes out, it's going to be deflected to the right. And that means that we have this air moving from inland out across us, okay? And just to prove that I'm not making this up, this is a textbook figure, but if we look at the pressure map right now, what have we got inland from us? A gigantic high pressure system. You can see we've got 1,036 HPA, okay? And so you can see how those isobars are also relatively close together. We're seeing relatively fast winds today. And again, it's going to come out of that high, and it's going to be deflected to the right, so it comes out across our area. So that's why it's so hot today. So the other reason that it's so hot and dry is that that area inland is raised up again. It's not at sea level inland. It's much higher up in altitude. And so as that air comes out of the desert, first of all, how much moisture is going to be in the air from inland anyway? Not very much. It's going to be relatively little. And then we take that air and we bring it down through the mountains into the LA Basin. And so it's adiabatically compressing, so it's warming, and we have very little moisture to begin with. It's going to get even drier. That relative humidity just drops through the floor. Okay, and what happens is that often around here is that wind gets funneled through the canyons as it comes down. And that's very bad news for us because, especially given how dry it is already, because we have such a dry winter, all of the vegetation is also really dry right now. And as that wind comes through, it strips out moisture from that vegetation, and we're much more susceptible to fires. And once those fires get going, it's really difficult and dangerous to fight them when we have these really, really fast winds going on, okay? So this is sort of our Santa Ana winds that we're experiencing, and we're gonna take a look later today at what happens to that high pressure system that's inland from us right now. How long does it stick around? How much longer are we gonna have really hot conditions? So, katabatic winds. I love the name of these, katabatic winds. So these are also to do with the fact that we have mountains or changes in altitude, but instead of air being forced by being part of a high pressure system to flow outwards and downwards, now we just have really, really, really cold air, and cold air is the opposite of hot air, so what does cold air do? It sinks, okay? And so this is especially true where we can get really, really cold air and one of the most obvious places we can get really, really cold air at quite high altitude is on top of our big ice sheets. So on top of Greenland, on top of Antarctica, when we have these enormous 3-4 kilometer thicknesses of ice, we can get this amazingly cold air, and it's really dense, because it's really cold, and so it sinks, and it basically flows down the edges. It's driven by gravity, it's driven by density again, rather than by a high pressure, for example. And so if you've ever gone camping on an ice sheet, which I don't imagine many people have, but you never know, then you start to experience things like this, which are pretty miserable. So you can see that air flowing down and outwards from the continent. Oh, it's a very short video, that one. So, but you can see that, and especially if you ever have been off a glacier, for example, then again, you can sometimes get these cold winds coming off the glacier if you've been on a cruise up to Alaska. So these are katabatic winds. They're driven by this cold air being really dense and flowing outwards. And the last of our little wind systems that we're going to talk about today are valley and mountain breezes. So if you've ever lived in the mountains, then you know that during the day, often there's a breeze that comes from the valley up the mountain. But at night, what you see instead is that we see a breeze coming down from the mountain. So let's think about why that might happen. So if we're thinking about our mountain, okay, the difference is that it's that the peak of that mountain is going to be higher up. There's going to be less air molecules in the way. So if we imagine sunlight coming through the atmosphere, it's going to have less chance to be scattered away, reflected away. And so it warms up that mountain top, more perhaps than the valley. Okay. And so if our warmer air is above the mountain, that's where air is going to rise. Okay. And that's where we create our little low compared to the valley. It's not quite as warm yet, and so we set up this relative high, relatively low, and we have this air movement from high to low. If we think about what happens at night, where does it cool down more quickly, at the top of the mountain or in the valley? At the top. If you've ever been camping up in the Sierras, you know it gets really cold at night. And let's think about why that is again. Why did we say that clouds were so good at keeping us warm? Yeah, absolutely, because they're absorbing that outgoing radiation. If we're up really high, we have less air molecules around in our atmosphere, we're going to have less air molecules that can act to absorb that outgoing radiation, so we're going to lose radiation more quickly out to space. We're going to cool down more quickly than the valley where there's more molecules around. Does that make sense? Yeah? Okay. So at night, we have warmer conditions in the valley. There we create some rising air, relative low, and that wind is going to instead move down the mountain. Okay? So these are our valley mountain breezes. So those are our little wind systems, and those are our local winds. So those are what differ from our big three-cell conceptual model because of the way that land and topography, whether we have mountains or valleys, things like that, mess with the system. So now we are going to move onwards to air masses, and you're going to be very pleased to hear that this is, I think, one of the easiest things that we ever do in this class. I'm sure you're relieved about that. The problem is that Thursday is one of the most challenging lectures that we have in the class. So I really would encourage you to come on Thursday just to hear it at least sort of a couple of times, because I think it's a challenging concept to get Thursday's class. So air masses are just a large volume of air. And that large volume of air will have a characteristic temperature and a characteristic humidity. Okay, and so that volume of air has the same temperature and same humidity within that sort of mass. Okay, so that's what we call an air mass. And so if you think about where they form, they're going to have to form in areas where you have very stable temperatures for large areas. So if you want to create a cold air mass, you're going to have to create it somewhere where it is very cold for a certain length of time over a large area. Okay? And so what that means is that really we can create nice sort of warm air masses over the sort of the tropics down near the equator. We can create really cold air masses up near the pole. But really at mid-latitudes, where even our weather is changing quite a bit from week to week, we really don't go and create these big air masses very often. Okay? Makes our life simpler though. And so where our air mass is created is called a source region. And so let's think about how we describe air masses based on humidity. There's just two options. They can be maritime, and they're maritime if they form over the ocean. If they form over the ocean, do you think they have high humidity or low humidity? High. Thank you. If they form over the continent, we call them continental. So that one isn't that tricky to get. So if they form over the ocean, we call them maritime. They have high amounts of water vapor. If they form over the continent, we call them continental. They tend to be pretty dry. They have low humidity, low amounts of water vapor. Slightly more complicated with temperature because we have three whole options. We get tropical. Do you think tropical is hot or cold? Thank you. I feel stupid asking you, but it makes the point. This is really hard to mess up. These are easy points in exams, okay? So tropical is down where it's sort of warmer near the equator. You can see in those mid-latitudes where we are, we really don't form air masses very often because conditions change too much from day to day and week to week. But then we have polar air masses, which are really quite cold. They form sort of up in Canada around that same sort of latitude. And then the very, very, very coldest air masses that we form are Arctic air masses. And those are right up near the pole. So we can create a little table showing the different types of air masses that we get. So our tropical air masses, they can be continental and dry, or maritime and contain lots of moisture. They can be polar, and they can be continental polar and be really cold and dry, or maritime polar, be cold and wet. And then we have Arctic. And we certainly have continental Arctic air, but we don't actually get maritime Arctic air. So why do you think we don't get maritime Arctic air? So that's my question for you. So first of all, I'm going to ask you an eye clicker in a second, but I want you to think for a second. What would the characteristics be of maritime Arctic air? Super cold and a certain amount of moisture. Okay. So, cut the question off the bottom. So tell me, why don't we get maritime Arctic air? Okay. So have a look at my explanations and think about which best fits. We somewhat agree, 75%. I wonder if it's the same 75% each time. So, for the people that put there are no maritime Arctic areas, what is most of the Arctic? It's an ocean. But I would accept a bit of that answer. Why might that actually not be the case? Ice, yeah, it's actually ice covered for much of the year, right? So even if it's over the ocean, it might not actually have access to that sort of nice water surface where we could have evaporation going on. In the summer, increasingly, sort of sadly for us, increasingly much more of that Arctic Ocean is available for evaporation to form, but we still don't get Arctic maritime. So why is that? You got the right answer, because if we're thinking about really super cold air, getting more Californian by the minute, super cold, okay? We're not going to be able to get much evaporation. We're not going to be able to get much moisture into that air before it becomes saturated. There's not going to be much energy around for evaporation, okay? So we just don't get air masses with that characteristic of really cold and moist, because it just can't sort of exist, okay? So that's why you only have 5 choices to make, which is very handy because you have an iClicker with A to E as an option. So here's a little map. I want you to spend a bit of time thinking about which letters you would put in each of those boxes there. And I'm going to give you 2 minutes or so to work that out, and then I'm going to ask you one at random. Okay? So have a think about that for a second. Okay? So I'm going to ask you, what is this air mass? Okay? And I'm not going to click on it because it'll show you again. So what letters would you write to describe that air mass? Okay, let's take a look. We have a clear winner, well, not that clear a winner, but yes, 68% or so agree with me that this would be maritime because it's forming over the ocean. Okay, so maritime is an easy one to do, and it is polar. Some people get a bit confused by this map because you can see that it curves around at the top. So do make note that these sort of the two on either side of that image look like they're further towards the pole just because of the way that the image is drawn. Okay. So what would the very center top air mass be? Yep, Arctic, definitely. What would that one underneath be? Continental polar. What about this one? What's about the one in the square box there? Okay. So vote again and tell me what the one in the square box there would be. We're still hovering at 70% or so, but yes. It would be continental because it's forming over land, and it would be tropical because it's forming down where it's really quite hot. Okay. These are easy points. There is no reason not to get these right. Okay. And every year people in the final somehow get these wrong. Okay. So if you're not clear about it, come speak to me or the TAs. These are easy points to make. Okay, so there's a little summary that I accidentally showed you before. What type of air masses can affect us here in Irvine? If you look at the arrows on there showing where they can move, which sort of masses can affect us here? Maritime tropical and maritime polar, right? A lot of our winter storms come down from that area up near the Aleutian Islands and around Alaska. But we also get things like our Pineapple Express storms that come up from the tropics. Okay. So let's think more about these air masses. So we've talked about what they are, where they form, and what their characteristic humidities and temperatures can be. But once they form, they don't just hang out there forever. They can move. And this is the influence that they start to have on our weather. So you saw where the arrow sort of pointed in that last diagram. And once they migrate, they cause changes. They affect the temperatures that we experience. They affect the humidities that we would experience as well. And so what happens when these things move is, first of all, the movement of that air will affect the conditions at a particular location. But also, as soon as you start to move that air mass away from its source region, as soon as you start to move it over, for example, warmer ground, then it itself is going to start changing. We can't take a polar air mass and sort of move it right to the equator and expect it to still be extremely cold. It will start to change as it moves over different areas. Okay? We also get these boundaries between air masses, especially when they're moving. And we've already talked about fronts, because we talked about fronts when we thought about why air rises. It's one of our lifting mechanisms. So really, our front is just a boundary between one air mass and another. And it allows us to define sort of what type of movement is going on. So this is the weather forecasting bit. This is what you hear when you listen to people tell you what's going to happen. So first of all, we have our cold front. What do you think happens to our temperatures as a cold front moves through? It gets colder, absolutely. The clue's in the name, it's not that complicated. So a cold front, it moves really quite fast. It moves at something like 30 miles an hour, and it's quite steep. So that sort of line between the warmer air on one side and the colder air on the other is going to be relatively steep. in the atmosphere. And you can see that as that cold front moves past, we're going to see a really sharp change in temperature, because that is a very steep line. We're also, because it's very steep in the atmosphere, only going to see very brief sort of periods of clouds and rainfall. Okay? Because if that line is really steep, then that's where that warm air is being forced up and over that cold front, and so that's where we're going to have that air rising. It doesn't happen either side, it happens absolutely at that front, or a little bit ahead of that front. So we just get this little line of clouds and rainfall along that front. So I want you to look at the symbols, those little blue arrows. Which side of those arrows, which side of those symbols is the cold air on? This seems to be something that is a challenge for everyone each year, remembering which side of the symbols the air masses are. 70% again, I can't get above that today. 70% say they're behind the symbols and they would be right. If you look where the blue arrows are, it's behind, okay? And then you can see that that line, that cold front, which is that blue line with the little triangles, the cold air is the other side from the triangles. So we have warm air ahead of that, and as that cold air comes in, it slides underneath that warm air, and that warm air is forced upwards. Okay? So that's our cold front. And this is what happens to our temperatures as a cold front moves through. You can see that up in Minneapolis right now, it's -5 degrees Celsius, really very cold. St. Louis is warmer, and Birmingham is even warmer than that. But look, as we see that a warm front moves through, we see a really dramatic change in temperature. And so when that happens, we obviously get colder. So if we have a cold front, fairly obviously, we're also going to have warm fronts. And this is where warm air is moving into an area where cold air has been before. So now we have warm air on the left trying to move and replace cold air on the right. In this case, these warm fronts move much more slowly, and they're much more shallow. That angle that they form in the atmosphere is much shallower. And let's think about why that is for a second. What happens if you have a bunch of cold air and you try and move warm air in? Where does it tend to go? Up and over. So really, it takes much more for that warm air to push out that cold air. Because with our cold air, it comes in and it just slides right underneath the warm air and it forces it to rise. When we have a warm front coming in, it struggles to do that because the cold air sort of wants to stay in place and the warm air is deflected up and over. So it's much slower moving than our cold fronts. And you can see that that also means that that shallower angle means that we have sort of more days or much more extensive cloud cover ahead of that front. If you imagine that we're stood on the right-hand side of that diagram, okay, our front is gradually moving towards us, so we experience really high clouds on sort of at first, and then as that warm front moves closer and closer, that cloud gets lower and lower and lower, and finally we might see rain for a while, okay, and then we have that warm air suddenly arriving, and then we have clear conditions and nice warm temperatures again. Does that make sense? Yep. Okay. So that's our warm front, rather. But look at what is happening with the precipitation. Especially if this happens relatively far north, then look at that precipitation is falling through cold air. So this is one of the situations where we can have that layer of cold air close to the ground, and then we can get things like sleet. We might get freezing rain, depending on the thickness of that. Stationary front, that's what it sounds like. It's stationary, okay? You have cold air on one side, warm air on the other side. It's not going anywhere. Then we have an occluded front. This is the slightly more challenging one. You can see that the way to spot it is that it's all purple. All the symbols, they're sort of both the little semicircles of the warm front and also the triangles of the cold front, but they're all on one side and they're all in the same color. So let's think about what happens with an occluded front, because in this case we have three air masses rather than two. So Which one is faster, my cold front or my warm front? Cold front. So if you look at my top diagram there, I have a little map showing the US, and I have a warm front ahead of a cold front. But if you look at the two maps below, then what happens is that that cold front is going to start catching up. It's moving faster, so it's going to start catching up with the cold front that's ahead of it. Okay? And once it catches up and it sort of melds, then we call that an occluded front. So my diagrams on the right-hand side show you what's happening at this point. So it's sort of slightly small, so I'm going to point out a couple of things. So what they've done is they've drawn a line of what would happen up in the atmosphere from A to B. And if you can look on here, this is sort of going from A to B. So the first thing that we do as we go along that line is we encounter a cold front. And it's steep, and we have cold air on one side and warm air on the other side. Okay? As we continue along that, the next thing we encounter is this warm front. And that's between our warm air here moving into cooler air on this side. Okay? So that's all pretty easy to cope with still. These are just the two different fronts, and they're in different places. But a little bit later, once that blue cold front has started catching up with our warm front, we're going to see something a little bit different. So now we're doing A to B again, A to B. And you can see that now my cold front has been moving faster, and it's caught up with my warm front. So now we'd have cold air on one side of my cold front and warm air on the other. But here we've got warm air and cooler air. That warmer air, the least dense, is going to be forced up. And so as my cold front continues moving, it becomes more and more occluded. It's basically like zipping it up. They sort of zip themselves together. Then you can see that now my cold air is still cold on one side, warm on the other side, but that cold front, that cold air, is even sliding underneath the cool air. Okay, so my warm air is being forced upwards and further upwards. And what happens to air as it's forced upwards? Does it expand or compress? Does it warm up or cool down? So we get clouds and rainfall. You can see that develops in that central patch. So even if we don't experience that warm air at the surface, if an occluded front passes us by, we get cool air being replaced by colder air. But that warm air is still up above. We don't feel it, but it's still up above. And the fact that it's being forced upwards still results in clouds and rainfall that we would experience. Okay? Does that make sense? That one's a bit more challenging. Yeah? Can you go one more time? Yes, I'm happy to do that. So, we have a cold front moving across, but it's going to start catching up with our warm front. And so what happens is they sort of zip themselves together through time. Okay? And that warm air that sort of was between, if we have our cold front moving in, I have cold air on this side, warm air on this side, okay? And then I have my warm front, where I have warm air on this side and cooler air on this side. So what happens is that warm air doesn't disappear as those things zip together. What happens is that warm air is forced out and upwards because that cold air sort of comes in and it slides underneath the warm air. And then as it catches up with my warm front, it even slides underneath the cooler air on the other side. Does that help a little bit? It's a lot to take in at once, I realize. So have a quick look at those diagrams. So think about that cold front catching up with my warm front. And we still have the three air masses, cold, warm, and coolish. And so what we end up with is that warm air up at the top, that cold air basically sliding in and underneath everything else. So this would be the line of my occluded front, okay, where those two fronts join together. We'll talk more about this on Thursday when we talk about mid-latitude cyclones. And the very, very last front isn't really a front because we call it a dry line. And a dry line is between two air masses which have the same temperature, but one is going to be much drier than the other. And the way that this is drawn is by a sort of a line with these sort of little loops, these half circles drawn on there, and it doesn't have a particular color. Okay? So I think those symbols are relatively easy and intuitive to remember, hopefully. So, let's think about dry lines. So if anyone lives in Texas, is anyone from Texas? No? No one from Texas? I don't believe you. So we have a dry line, and these tend to form in Texas an awful lot, and they tend to be associated sometimes with thunderstorms as well. And you can see if we picked a location somewhere ahead of that dry line that sort of moves through, then you can see, in terms of the time of day from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m., if you look at the temperature, it gets a bit warmer in the afternoon, but there's not a significant change in temperature. But what we can see is that from 3 p.m. onwards, you can see that there's a much higher dew point temperature in the morning, and then it suddenly drops at that 3 p.m. time, okay? And that would mark the passage of our dry line. And so you can see my question here. When the dew point temperature is lower, what does that mean about how much water vapor is in my air? Is there more or less? So now I'm really asking you to dredge through your memory a little bit. So can you remember? Too close. Think about it again. Speak to the person behind you. Not going to let you get away with that. You can remember this. Okay, are there any last votes for me? Right, let's take a look and see if we get a better idea this way time round. Somewhat better. I still can't top 75% today, can I? So let's take a quick look, given that this seems to be a challenge. So, everyone's favorite graph. We haven't seen it for a while. I'm sure you're sad. So, what is my dew point temperature? It's the temperature at which we become saturated. So if I think about a particular temperature, say if I have a nice cold dew point temperature, say I have, I don't know, I'll do Fahrenheit for you because I'm feeling kind, 35 Fahrenheit, I would go up and this would be the amount of vapor pressure in that air. Does that make sense? Ringing a bell? So if I have more vapor pressure, then is my dew point temperature going to be higher or lower? Higher. Okay, it's going to be, I don't know, 55 or something instead. Okay, so the higher the dew point temperature, the more moisture there is in that air. So what we're seeing happening in this particular example is that we're not changing the temperature between 2 and 3, but we're really dramatically changing the amount of water vapor in that air, and so that humidity would drop really very quickly. Okay? Great. So, I heard that groan. It's not that bad. So, the real world is always a little bit of a mess, unfortunately. I don't like showing you the perfect textbook examples because the world isn't like that. And I think it's much more interesting if we actually look at what the weather was like on Friday. So this is from Friday. Does anyone remember what the weather was like on Friday? No? Is it too long ago now? Possibly. I remember because I was sat outside in the evening and I was extremely cold, okay? Why might I have been cold on Friday? We had a cold front move through, so it was actually much warmer earlier in the week. And on Friday, I was sat outside in the evening and it got really cold, okay? Because we saw a cold front pass through, okay? It was slightly cloudier as well, okay? So can you spot for me a stationary front? A little bit of one. Everyone seems to be pointing in the right direction. Yep, perhaps over here, you can see that we have little cold sort of front arrows on one side, warm front arrows, or warm circles on the other. So it's a stationary front. Here might be a bit of a stationary front. Can anyone spot me a bit of an occluded front? Yeah. Up here in the middle? Okay. So, I have an interesting question for you. Are these fronts associated with areas of low pressure or high pressure? Low. They're always really associated with these low pressures. Why do you think that is? What's happening at low pressure areas? What is air doing at the surface? It's doing that, right? It's moving in all directions. And so that makes sense. We're going to see fronts when we have air moving together because we're more likely to be bumping different air masses into each other. If we imagine what's happening at a high, we have air moving out from that location in all directions. We're not going to be moving air together. We're not going to be bumping that air into each other. Okay, so that was Friday, and it's all very well, but it's not terribly exciting. Where was it raining? Where is the most obvious point where it's raining? Great Lakes again. They haven't been having a good time. It always rains over there. Okay, so those green splodges represent rain, and you can see that it's often, not always, but often associated with areas of low and where we have fronts. So, I have a bit of a challenge for you, and we have some time for this. I am going to show you our weather for the next few days. So this is our little weather map for Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday. So, let's have a think about how to look at these. So first of all, I think hopefully a lot of you have them in your notes, but if not, I'll start scrolling through them. I want you to look at what happens here in Irvine. We're not going to forecast for anywhere else. We're going to be selfish and forecast for us here. And I want you to think about what is happening to the pressure here. Is it high to begin with? Is it low to begin with? Does it get higher or lower throughout the week? How strong will the winds be here? And which way will they be going? I want you to think about, will temperature change? And what's the most obvious way of working out if temperature is going to sharply change? Look for a front, okay? So are there any fronts moving past us? And if that front does move past us, think about where that air mass is coming from. Are we gonna see changes in humidity, perhaps through the week? And will there be clouds? Rainfall, of course, we don't get rainfall, but will there be clouds at some point in our future? Okay? So think about those things. Pressure, increasing, decreasing. How strong will the winds be? What direction will they be going? Will the temperature change? Will humidity change? Might we get clouds at any point in our future? Okay? So for those of you with your own printouts of the notes, you can get started, but otherwise I will start scrolling through. Okay? And the TAs will get up and wander around and help you out as well. So here we are. Here's Irvine. Okay. So Thursday, are the Santa Ana winds going to be gone or are they still going to be bothering us? Yeah. We have still got at least two more days of these Santa Ana winds still to go. It's not going to be very pleasant. But the good news is, if we look at Friday, We've got this high pressure out to the ocean. But what do we have on Saturday next to us inland? Low. So where is the wind going to come from? Is it going to be going from inland out to sea? Where is our wind going to be coming from here? It's going to come in from the sea. And so we're going to start cooling down a little bit on Saturday. Please, can you be quiet? We still have 5 minutes left. So we're going to start cooling ourselves down a little bit on Saturday. We have this low pressure inland from us. Our pressure is going to be dropping to that point. Okay? But what can you see approaching from the north? A cold front. And so if we look through time, what is it going to be like on Sunday? Is it going to be calm or windy? Relatively windy, potentially. And look what happens between Sunday and Monday. What's going to happen Monday? We're going to get nice and cool, and we are going to stay that way for a while. Now let's think about what happens with humidity. Okay? So we've had these sundown winds. What do you think our humidity is like right now? It's going to be really low. As we start changing our wind directions, we start seeing air coming from the ocean, what's going to happen to our humidity? It's going to increase. Where is that air coming from? Where is that cold air coming from as it moves down towards us? What type of air mass would it be? It's going to be maritime polar, right? It's going to have formed over the Pacific. So it's again likely to have high humidity. So what do you think we also might see on Monday in some of the days afterwards?
Rain.
Clouds. Sadly not rain. We're not that lucky. But sadly clouds. So, before you go, I want to see, are we right? Okay? So, let's have a look at whether we were right. So it's pretty hot out there right now. Look. Please don't back up this year. I can't talk over you. Okay. So, let's look at all the various things we have going on. So here's Thursday. We're looking at Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday. You can see that, yes, the next couple of days we still have those Santa Anas going. Please don't talk. I'm not going to talk over you. Okay. So we have these Santa Ana winds going, but remember, Friday, Saturday, we start to see that wind coming off the ocean. It cools down a lot. Our green line shows the humidity, our humidity rises. And then on Monday, we see that cold front come through, and we have nice cold conditions for a while. And as that happens, we also see partly cloudy conditions forming as well, as we get that higher humidity, as we get that marine layer coming off the ocean. Okay? You can also see that the winds change direction. This is what it is right now. It's really coming at us from inland. But as we move through time, start to see this sort of little reversal of winds throughout the day, these arrows sort of backwards and forwards. And those are our sea and land breezes kicking in again. And so we start to see a little sort of sea and land breeze. And here in grey, I can't get this column to go away, but here in grey you can see the cloud cover. So we're going to start to see cloud cover, and especially in the mornings, we're going to start to see that beginning of that marine layer, and the June gloom is starting to sort of bloom in our future. Okay? So we can do surprisingly well with what you've got already. You are future weather forecasters. Okay, thank you guys. I'll see you on Thursday.